Hi, this video is on monoprotic acids and bases with a focus on the interactions with water and on buffers. One of the things that's often not discussed in Gen Chem is the fact that if you have a really dilute acid or base, a strong acid or base, and it's dilute enough that the contribution from the acid and base is equivalent to that of water, the things get a little complicated. So we have to recall that water all in its own will split to form H plus and OH minus. And this autoprotolysis forms about 10 to the minus 7 molar H plus. And this is just neutral water, pure, no other acids or bases present. And so if we have a strong acid or base whose concentration is within a factor of 10 of this, so that means 10 to the minus 6 or 10 to the minus 8th molar, and that's the blue zone on the graph on the right, we really have almost equivalent contributions from both water autoprotolysis and the acid or base. And so we have to consider both, and that's called systematic treatment of equilibria. In the case where we're at the far right of this diagram over here, what's occurring is that we have so little contribution from the strong acid or base because its concentration is less than 10 to the minus 8 molar, then really the strong acid or base is not contributing enough of the H plus or OH minus to change the pH. And so if you're that dilute, if you're 10 to the minus 8 molar or less, then the pH is going to be 7 because it's dominated by the splitting of water. On the other hand, if your strong acid or base concentration is greater than 10 to the minus 6 molar, the acid or base dominates the equilibrium and you can ignore water. So how do we deal with this? Here's an example of 1 times 10 to the minus 8th molar KOH, which is of course a strong base. What we do is we make an ice chart, so initial, change, and end. And initially we're going to consider the contribution of OH minus coming from this strong base. And so we're going to think about that as the dominant thing, and then we'll think about how water will react to adjust its equilibrium to account for this. So initially, we're going to pretend that there is zero contribution from H plus and from H2O. And we have that 1 times 10 to the minus 8th from the KOH. Now the change here is that some of the water is going to dissociate, so minus X on that side, and produce X molecules each of H plus and OH minus. And so in the end, what we're really focusing on in purple here is the fact that we have an H plus of X from water, and the OH minus has the 1 times 10 to the minus 8th from the KOH, but it also has a contribution from water. And now we bring in our friend, the KW. And we always have to remember that if we're working with something in water, that KW has to apply. And so we have our constant of KW, and it has to be equal to the H plus concentration times the OH minus concentration. And assuming that KW is 1 times 10 to the minus 14, we're able to then take our X for H plus and plug that in, and we're able to take the whole contribution of 1 times 10 to the minus 8th plus X, plug that in for OH minus, and calculate this out. And so when you distribute that, you find that you have a quadratic equation, and you really should solve this quadratic equation. There's really not a good idea to assume anything is too small. And when you get the two options, of course, concentration has to be positive. So you can't consider the negative concentration option. So we have here now X is 9.5 times 10 to the minus 8th molar. And if you take the negative log of that to get pH, we get 7.02. And this is a base, right? So this is slightly basic, slightly more basic than neutral water. But it's also pretty close to 7 because we do have a very low concentration of base. One of the morals of this story is that water will hardly ever produce 10 to the minus 7 molar H plus and 10 to the minus 7 molar OH minus. For example, we have a fairly strong acid, 10 to the minus 4 molar HBr, so super strong acid. If you do this, the pH is 4, and that's because you have 10 to the minus 4 molar of H plus coming from the strong acid. Now, water is still doing its autoprotolysis thing at the same time, and so we can consider how much OH minus must be present. Again, using KW. And so the KW here is shown in a rearranged form where we've isolated the OH minus on the side. And we still have KW is 1 times 10 to the minus 14. And we have H plus coming from the molarity of the HBr as 10 to the minus 4. So that means OH minus concentration in this solution is 10 to the minus 10 molar. But the only way you can get that OH minus is from the splitting of water. And if you get an OH minus out of water, the water is also producing the same quantity of H pluses. So really, water is not producing very much H plus here, 10 to the minus 10, which is 6 orders of magnitude less than the strong acid. And it all comes down to Le Chatelier's principle. Having this acid or base that you add in is going to suppress water ionization because you're increasing one of these two terms on the product side of water dissociation. Increase the products, shift it back to the left, and you're going to have much less of the water ionization. Now with weak acids and bases, some of the same principles apply. To review weak acids and bases from our intro to equilibrium, one of the important things to remember is the acid dissociation constant. So we have HA as our general term for a weak acid, and it dissociates to form some H plus and some A minus. Now the difference between this and strong acids is that this is only partial. With base, the weak base is going to abstract a hydrogen off of water and leave behind OH minus in solution, leaving it as a basic solution. And for the conjugate pair, which differs by the one exchange of protons, then the Ka times the Kb is equal to our Kw. If we want to solve a weak acid problem properly, what we need to consider is the fact that we have multiple reactions. One of those reactions, of course, is the weak acid reaction right here. But the other reaction that's always going on in aqueous solution is our Kw, which I just circled in green, where you have the water undergoing autoproteolysis. And so if we really want to solve all of these contributions, then we have to consider the fact that all of our charges, all of the H+, has to balance out by all of our anions. So we have the A- and the OH-. We also know that the formal concentration of acid that's been added in, so formal concentration is like molarity, but for all of the components, for the acid is the sum of the weak base and weak acid components, because of course it's split up. And so some of it's in one form, some of it's in the other. Now we have four unknowns here. We have A minus, we have HA, we have H plus, and we have OH minus. And we have several different equations. We have this charge balance equation, that's one. We have the mass balance equation, that's another. And then mercifully, we have Ka equation and we have Kw equation. And you know from math class that if you have four unknowns and you have four equations, it's possible to solve concentrations of everything if you can just do the algebra. Now, one of the assumptions that we'll make, and it's a usually fair assumption, is to say that any respectable weak acid is going to contribute much more H plus than just water dissociation. And so we approximate this charge balance equation, which is this one right here, by getting rid of the OH minus. We say, okay, you know what? The OH minus is really not a big contribution here. It's mostly that the weak acid is the dominant thing. And so we're going to say the H plus concentration is approximately equal to A minus concentration. That means that the essence of our weak acid problem is the H plus equals A minus. And so when we get to simply Ka equation, what we're able to do is put these two equal, call both of them x, and you therefore get x squared there, and you get the formal concentration minus x on the bottom. And it turns out that for the weak base problem, you have the same setup. We recognize that the OH minus is approximately equal to BH plus, and those are both x, and so we still get Kb equals x squared over F minus x, but in this case, it's the x is OH minus, whereas up there, x was H plus and A minus. So weak acid, weak base problem, if you're ever trying to get concentrations and pHs, is to remember the K equals x squared over F minus x, and then keep in mind what x must be. There are a couple of other mathematical terms which are not too hard, actually, so this looks complicated, but it's not a difficult concept. For an acid, we have the fraction of dissociation. So remember, HA is in equilibrium to dissociate to H plus and A minus. So how much of it dissociated? Well, however much became A minus over the total, and of course the total is HA plus A minus. So here's our total, HA plus A minus, and then the amount that dissociated is the A minus. Well, geez, okay. A minus is X, and down the total, well, the total is the total you put in, which is formal concentration. So fraction of dissociation, alpha, is X over F. You guessed it, fraction of association for base is the same concept. And so in this case, now you have the base taking on water and being like, hey, water, can I have your proton? Sure, no problem. And we end up with BH plus, that's the associated part. So we say associated because it's gained something, right? Gained. And OH minus. And again, the amount that went forward to do this goes on top, and the total of both portions of the weak base goes on bottom. And so we get X over F. You'll want to be able to identify conjugate acid-base pairs, especially as we go forward into discussing buffers. And depending on how you look at it, you can look at the weak acid either as the BH plus form right here, or as the HA form right there. So this is the formic acid formate pair, basically going back and forth. You can look at formic acid losing its proton to make formate as the A minus. You can also look at formate as B, right? So there it is up there, A minus, there it is down there as the B. So either way that you want to make your abbreviations is fine, but be able to always recognize which is the acid and which is the base. It's worth pointing out a couple of things about the relationship between these conjugate acids and bases. The first of these is that if you have a weak acid, the conjugate base of that is a weak base. So the conjugate of a weak is a weak. The conjugate acid of a weak base is also therefore a weak acid. And the strengths of these are opposite of each other. And that's because of the Kw term. So remember that Kw is a constant. Okay, and so if HA becomes a weaker acid, which means a smaller equilibrium constant, in order to make Kw be the multiplication of those, by necessity, Kb must go up. So if you have a weaker acid, then the conjugate base becomes a stronger base to balance that out, and vice versa. You have a stronger acid, then you have a weaker conjugate base. You can take this to extreme. If you have HA as a strong acid, then the conjugate base is so weak that it's actually not a base at all in water. And you think about sodium hydroxide, which is a super strong base, and the conjugate acid is sodium plus. Sodium plus is actually not an acid, and that's because it's the conjugate acid of such a strong base. Okay, pKa. P values are really fun. P means negative log of something. So if you have a pKa, it's the negative log of Ka. You can also have, of course, pKb and pKw. As your Ka increases, which means more dissociation, so like right here, we've got the formic acid, has a larger Ka than the benzoic acid. As your Ka increases, the pKa decreases. This means the smaller pKa means a stronger acid. You want to keep that in mind when you're looking at the pKa tables. Here are two acids. They're both hydroxybenzoic acid, and one is ortho, which means that you've got these two neighbors right here, and the other one is para right there. I had a moment when I was having a meta moment. Okay, so it turns out that the pKa of ortho hydroxybenzoic acid is 2.97. That means smaller pKa, which is a more acidic number, is going to be your more acidic acid. And why is that? Why is the ortho actually a stronger acid? Well, for those of you that love organic chemistry and hate analytical, we're going to have an organic moment. The fact is that when you have this dissociation product and this hydrogen here on the carboxylic acid pops off, but then you get this lovely internal hydrogen bond right there between the neighboring alcohol and the carboxylate. If you go to the appendix of your analytical book for our particular class, it is Appendix 11, there are going to be Ka values. And I apologize, this slide is kind of busy. My goal here is for you to understand that in most of these appendices, the compound name is of the neutral compound. Lovely. But the drawing is of the fully acidic form. And sometimes the fully protonated, fully acidic form the drawing is does not match the name. How will you know? If the drawing has a charge of zero, like these top two, then the name of the neutral compound matches the drawing, which of course is neutral. However, down here, if you have any kind of charges drawn on there, be they positive or negative, most likely positive because we are fully acidic, because those have positive charges and the names are for neutral and neutral isn't positive, that means the names in the drawings don't match. So be really careful in identifying your acids and bases. All right, buffers. I like buffers. Buffers are acid slayers, like Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Hopefully you're not too young for that reference. All right, so what is a buffer? Buffered solutions resist change in pH. So if you add acid or base, then the pH is not going to change very much compared to just adding acid or base to water. Also, if dilution occurs, the pH of the buffer will not change very much. Buffers are a mixture of weak acids and their conjugate bases. So it's not just any weak acid, weak base pairing. It has to be a conjugate acid base pair. There also have to be comparable amounts of the conjugate acid and base, and so they have to have concentrations that are within a factor of 10 of each other to have significant buffering effects. And you might have noticed the emphasis here on conjugate acids and bases, which means you better be able to identify conjugate and acid-base pairs in order to solve buffer problems. If we mix A moles of weak acid and B moles of weak base together, the moles of acid stays close to the original A and the moles of base stays close to the original B. So you get what you mix with buffers. Why? Great question. The answer to why is Le Chatelier's principle. So let's take a moment to think about this weak acid hypothetical pKa of 4. If we have a 0.1 molar solution of it, then we have HA dissociating and we're losing the 0.1, right? So we're losing X quantity of it. And we have Ka equals x squared over f minus x, and that gives us a certain x value. Now, pKa of 4 is fairly reasonable. And what's going on here is we ultimately get this fraction of dissociation here of x over f, and this tells us that Ha dissociates 3.1%, which is pretty little. If we think about mixing this weak acid, which dissociates 3.1% to make a few protons, with some of its conjugate base, A minus, then by Le Chatelier's principle, if this A minus increases, we are sending that equation backwards. And so adding A minus makes this HA dissociate even less. The conjugate base of this must have a pKb of 10 because pKa plus pKb equals 14. And we go ahead and we calculate the same idea. And we get the fraction of association of the base is 3.2 times 10 to the minus 5th, which is pretty small. Okay, that's a fraction, so you can multiply that by 100%, but it's still very tiny. And we see that A minus does not react much with water. So if it's already not particularly willing to go in the forward direction and we increase the HA concentration by having both present, you're pushing that back as well. So the presence of each of the conjugate acid and base pair are basically pushing against each other in this tug of war of Le Chatelier's principle. Now, what happens if we add an acid or base to a buffer? Well, strong acids and bases are always going to react completely with whatever else is there. So if we add in the strong acid of pure H plus, essentially, it will react with the weak base and it will create the conjugate weak acid. But we already have some of that, right? Because it's a buffer. If you have the strong base being added, it will react with the weak acid, so your strong base, OH minus, and it will react with the weak acid and make some of the conjugate base. But you already have some conjugate base present, you already have some conjugate acid present, and we also know that neither of these is going to particularly make much of H plus or H minus because they're pushing against each other. As a final note, it's worth reminding you that strong plus strong reacts completely, so even more completely. So you do have neutralization of strong acids and strong bases to make water. So the beauty of buffers is that the pH of the buffer changes very little when you add a limited amount of strong acid or base. The famous buffer equation is the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, sometimes lovingly referred to as the HH equation. So we have HH, Henderson-Hasselbalch. And you really should memorize this. Any of these giant blue stars next to equations means you better memorize it. pH equals pKa plus log of A minus over HA. Note that the acid is always on the bottom, right? And that's a plus. This is essentially a very handy rearrangement of our weak acid equilibrium expression. So you have HA going to H plus and A minus, you have KA being the products over the reactants of that. And if you just look at that KA term that I just circled, you think about taking the log of both sides. And so we can take the log of KA, and we can take the log of this hunk right there, and then you can go back to your fancy log rules and realize that if you have something in here that's a multiplication, you can split it out into two separate terms that are added to each other. And then if you just want to swap sides, I'll switch colors for you. If I move the log of H plus to the left by subtracting it, and I move the log of Ka to the right by subtracting it, now I suddenly have negative log of H plus. Aha, that's pH, because I moved that over there. And I suddenly have negative log of Ka, pKa, because I moved that over there. And then we just leave the log of A minus over HA all on its own, because we don't have a fancy name for that. Cool, huh? Now there are two forms of the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, depending on your preference for making a weak acid be HA or BH plus. Whichever way you want to go, that's fine. And just remember that the acid is always on the bottom of this log term. And I like to think of that as a pyramid because you have the H there, it makes it bigger, and HA looks larger than just A minus, BH looks larger than B, and you want to have a big wide base on your pyramid. So whatever it is that you're working with, put the acid on the bottom of this term in the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, and make sure that you're using a pKa that applies to that acid on the bottom. Properties of the HH equation are that if you have equal quantities of A minus and HA, then the pH equals pKa. So you look at this log term here, and if they're equal quantities to each other, that becomes log of 1. Log of 1 is 0, and so pH equals pKa. It's really handy to know that. Also, all of the equilibria in the solution have to be satisfied. You can only have one H plus concentration in any given solution. It's not possible to have multiple H plus concentrations in a solution. Furthermore, every time you have a power of 10 change in that ratio of A minus over HA, the pH is going to change by 1 unit. So equal quantities, boom, right there, 1 to 1, pH equals pKa. As soon as you have more base, then the pH is 1 unit above, right? So 10 to 1 is 1 unit above, 100 to 1 more base than acid is 2 units above. Now let's do a quick buffer example. Bleach, household bleach, is a solution of sodium hypochlorite. Note to self, everybody, if you see things like sodium in there, it's there simply as a counter ion. The sodium is going to become its sodium plus, and this is telling you you have OCl minus, which is essentially A minus. So sodium hypochlorite is, of course, then a base. So if it's a base and we have tables of weak acids, you have to go and look up the conjugate weak acid, which is hypochloric acid, or HOCl. And that has a Ka of 3 times 10 to the minus 8. So we could ask ourselves a question like, what's the ratio of base to acid in bleach if the pH happens to be 7? To move forward with that question, we have to take that Ka value and convert it to pKa. So you take the negative log of it. In this case, that turns out to be 7.52. You take the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, pH equals pKa plus log of basic form over acidic form. And you plug in the pH of 7 for this particular solution, where pH goes, and you plug in pKa, where pKa goes. Isolate the two numbers on the left-hand side, so you're subtracting the 7.52 from both sides. And then you can undo the log by taking a 10 to the power of. And so 10 to the power of minus 0.52 equals 0.3. And that equals the ratio that we desire. So we have 30% as much of the basic form of OCl minus as we do of the acidic form, HOCl. The pH of a buffer is almost independent of volume. It's not completely because of ionic strength and activity and complicated things like that. But it's almost independent of volume. And that's because the volume in the numerator and denominator of this log term cancel out And so we have the acidic form down here, molarity, moles per liter. We have the basic form up there, moles per liter. And as shown here, liters of solution cancel out in both of them. And so you really can leave your calculations for buffers in terms of moles. Now, you can't leave all your calculations for acid base in terms of moles, but for buffers, you can. So let's do an example here. The pH of a 1 liter buffer solution that you make with 12.43 grams of tris and 4.67 grams of tris hydrochloride. First things first, what is the acid? What is the base? If you don't have Google available to you, then that kind of sucks for you, but it's probably identified on your test. So if we do have Google, or if we do have our acid base table, what we'll find out is the following information, that tris is actually a base, and so this right here is tris, and we have its formula mass or molecular weight. And we see that tris hydrochloride has to be the conjugate acid. And when you go look up that conjugate acid, we have a pKa of 8.072. All right, so we have a liter. We have a certain number of masses for these two things. Well, all right, gotta get to moles. So first things first, we know tris is the base. We got the pKa. We figure out the calculations. We're gonna put this into Henderson-Hasselbalch. So dividing each of the masses by the molecular weights gives us molarity. And then we can set up Henderson-Hasselbalch, where you put your pKa in, 8.072, and then the log term, where again, it's the base on top, right there, over the acid on the bottom. So turns out pH is 8.61 in this case. Now, buffers, of course, are fabulous because if you add acid or base to them, the pH doesn't change much. So what is the pH if we add 12 mils of 1 molar HCl? What happens? The first thing is always figure out the reaction. So you're going to have the H plus from the strong acid react with the weak base, and it's going to form more of the HB, conjugate weak acid. How much? Well, buffer things, you really should all discuss this in terms of moles. So if we added 12 milliliters, that's 0.012 liters times 1 molar, it's 0.012 moles of the HCl. And that's going to neutralize through this reaction right here, the same number of moles of tris. So we're gonna do an ice chart. And if we're working in moles, we better work in moles for all compounds. 1 liter makes this freakishly helpful, right? So multiply those molarities by 1 liter gives you the same number of moles, aren't we lucky? Now, ice chart, initial moles. So we've got the initial moles of tris, boom. We have the initial moles of the conjugate acid, tris hydrochloride, and we have the moles of HCl. They're going to react with each other, so you're subtracting this HCl neutralization amount from both sides, or from the left side anyway, and adding it to the right side, so that's your change. And then that gives you your final moles, your end pole. And if we take then our pH equals pKa plus log of those things, it's those logs of the final moles of B and BH plus that you put in there, and you bring that pKa forward. And so now we have a pH that's only very slightly changed of 8.41. Okay, well, that was 12 mils of acid. What about 150 mils? Again, we look at how many moles of acid we're adding. If we add 150 mils of 1 molar acid, that's 0.15 moles of HCl. Now we have a problem. There was only 0.1026 moles of tris, the base, in that buffer in the first place. So you can't react 0.15 moles if you never had 0.15 moles. This is going to completely consume the tris. It's going to react completely. There's going to be no tris left. You're going to have excess H+. You will have completely consumed this buffer, and the remaining H+ would stay in the solution and make this considerably more acidic. Moral of the story here is that buffers do have a capacity, and you can increase the concentration of the buffer. So if you had more tris, then you'd be able to absorb this much acid and have a greater buffer capacity. So dilute buffers can only handle so much addition of acid or base. The buffer capacity is a measure of how well a solution resists the change in pH, and it does have a mathematical definition, which I show you here. The little d here is derivative, right? So change. So it's the concentration in moles of strong acid or base required to produce a single change in pH, so a unit change, pH of 1. The more base it takes to change the pH by 1 unit, the greater the buffer capacity. Because those have little d values for derivative, it's also reminding you that this is the derivative of a plot of moles of base added versus pH. So up top, we simply have the addition of a lot of base versus the pH. And if you take the first derivative of that, then we have the buffer capacity. And right here, by the pKa, we see a peak in buffer capacity. So buffer capacity is greatest near the pKa of the weak acid. Now, final topic for this is how to prepare a buffer. A moment back, we mixed in theory tris and tris hydrochloride. That's something you can do. The other thing you can do is you can just take one of those compounds, like tris hydrochloride, and then convert some of it to its conjugate using a strong acid or base. So in this case, if we have tris hydrochloride, which is the acid, we have 10 grams of tris hydrochloride. We can react that with sodium hydroxide. Strong base plus weak acid makes some of the weak base conjugate. If you have half molar sodium hydroxide, how much of it do you need to add to 10 grams? If you want pH of 7.6 and say 250 mL of solution. Well, we know the tris hydrochloride is the acid. We know it's going to react with the strong sodium hydroxide to create the base. We also know from our molecular weight from an earlier slide how many moles of the weak acid we have. And if you were thinking ice chart, you were thinking right. So we set it up with initial, change, and final, or end. That's where the E comes from. Isn't it cute when we make acronyms that we don't actually label? So end. And to start with, we have the 0.0635 moles. Always do your ice charts in moles, super important. If you have the 0.0635 of BH plus, and you do have a quantity of OH minus that you've added in, we don't know how much of the OH minus we've added in. We'll call it X. They're gonna react. We're going to subtract X from those two, creating X moles of B, the conjugate base. And so because you are using up all of the OH minus that you've added, it becomes a zero at the end. And we have produced X of conjugate weak base. We have lost X of the conjugate acid that was originally there. And if we take our pH equals pKa plus log, we put our desired pH right there. We've got the pKa of tris hydrochloride. And we put the moles of base on top. And we put the moles of acid on bottom, all the way on bottom. And that's just a matter of algebra. So first things first, subtract those numbers on the left-hand side. So get 8.072 subtracted from both sides. It's going to then produce this 0.472. And that's equal to the log term. Undo the log by doing 10 to the power of. 10 to the power of minus 4.72 is 0.3373. That's equal to the ratio then. And now you need to bring the bottom of that ratio up. There you go. Distribute that out. Get the x's all on one side. And then divide to isolate the x. And if you do that, we get 0.01602 moles of OH minus. It's okay to keep extra sig figs for now. How many milliliters of the 0.5 molar does it take to get that many moles? Well, we can do that too. So moles divided by moles over liters, and we get 0.032 liters or 32 mils. So in theory here, we mix 32 mils of 0.5 molar sodium hydroxide with 10 grams of tris hydrochloride, 250 mils. Hey, we never even used the 250 mils. It's all about moles. And it'll give us a pH of 7.6. Now, you're going to have a lot of those calculations. They're useful. But in reality, there are things that complicated it. So although we just calculated we should put 32 mils in there, in real life, we would not measure out 32 mils and do it because we wouldn't actually get 7.6. In real life, what we would actually do is we dissolve the 10 grams in about 80% of the water that we wanted, so roughly 80% of the 250 mils. We would calibrate a pH meter and put that in. Then we would add the 0.5 molar sodium hydroxide and stir until we got the pH we wanted. And then we'd make a quantitative transfer, transferring all of that liquid into a 250 ml volumetric flask to accurately control that final volume. We'd fill it to the line and we would mix. Now, what is it that's so complicated? It is this thing called activity. And activity is covered in a different video, but activity is essentially that the concentration of salts and ionic compounds in a solution are going to change how things act, thus activity. So H plus concentration is not actually what governs pH, it's H plus activity, which has to do with all the ionic stuff in the solution. It gets very complicated. And that's the reason why buffer calculations are good approximations, but in real life, you're just gonna mix it until you get the right pH. Okay, there's your introduction to monoprotic acid bases, how they interact with water, and buffers. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you.